Well, here we are. It is Friday evening, and I am shooting Sunday Morning Quickies. I have to apologize. This one is not going to be stellar. Full disclosure, I was at a family gathering last weekend, and myself and a bunch of other people in the family, we contracted COVID-19. Now, yes, I have been fully vaccinated. I even had COVID once before we even knew it was COVID. I had it in January of 2020. So I'm lucky. My symptoms weren't too bad this time around compared to the last one. The last one, I was running a fever of 104.3 for like 4 days. This time around, it got up there, but it only lasted a few hours. Yesterday, my primary care physician sent me to local hospital, and I got the monoclonal antibodies infusion treatment, also known as the Regeneron treatment. They said, "Yo, you'll feel great in just a couple of hours." Well, that turned out to be like 16 hours, and I went through some hell, but it's still better than having what I had the last time. And I understand vaccines aren't 100%, and, you know, medicine is still medicine. It's not a super exact science as yet, but it's still science nonetheless. Anyway, I have been working on this 285 with hopes of putting a video out this week on it, an in-depth video. What I'm going to do is I've gone through and I've done a couple of things on this machine or with this machine that look kind of interesting. So I'm just going to edit a bunch of that stuff together as just a couple of, here's a few interesting things to know about the Singer 285. This is a 285J in this case. Hopefully by next week, I'll be back in full force. As a matter of fact, next week is going to be a special edition of Sunday Morning Quickies. I got something very special planned for that. And but other than that, yeah, there's a couple things I do want to show you before I get away from this angle here. I know I published a quick, like, 2-minute video on this earlier this week. If you do have a 285 and you're going to plan on taking it apart, this screw here is a left-hand thread, not a right-hand thread, so it's righty-loosey, lefty-tighty. This here is not a screw. There's actually a screw on the face of the machine up here that releases the pin that's attached to. This is an eccentric that controls the amount of free play in the rack to the pinion gear. So just be aware of that before you go digging too deep into one of these things. That's about all you really need to know before you get going, other than the fact that in the needle bar area, the normal screw here, which would of course would be an opposite thread, is still an opposite thread, but you also have an opposite thread screw up here at the pivot point. So other than that, let me go on to the other stuff that I grabbed some video of, and we'll get this done. First thing I want to talk about is the rack from the rack and pinion mechanism and cleaning it. I'm going to use a rotary tool with a stainless steel wire brush to get the schmoo out of here. You can see this one's pretty nasty looking. Okay, now with the crap out of the teeth, I'm going to just take it to the buffing wheel. All right, this generated an awful amount of heat, but it does look considerably better now. Okay, that looks better. You know, one of the nice things about having
standards higher than that of the original parts manufacturer. This connecting rod that connects the where the rack and pinion connects to the vertical rock shaft, it had a lot of molding flash. This is an aluminum piece, and that flash had a lot of sharp edges. And the way I cleaned it, I took it out to the other shop out in the garage where I've got a bigger motor that has a 6-inch wire wheel, a very fine wire wheel on it. And I knocked back a lot of the corrosion first on all sides, including the sides that aren't going to be seen. And once again, this is what happens when you have standards higher than the manufacturer. This surface will never be seen. This surface is perfect now. But then I took it to my drill press, where I have a flap wheel from Stockroom Supply. I'll put a link to the company in the description below. And I used a very fine sandpaper flap wheel. And it's not a flap wheel where the sandpaper sheets are going vertically and smacking like this. It's a horizontal and they're split. You'll see if you follow the link what they look like. It works great for cleaning a lot of this stuff up. You just have to be super careful when you use them, which is why I haven't shown any videos yet. I eventually will. I'm going to mount it on the lathe and show you how to do it on the wood lathe. But that's why I haven't shown it before. It's great for getting this stuff knocked down, cleaning up and smoothing those super rough and sharp edges. Awesome thing. But it makes the parts look really, really nice. Okay, here's some more interesting stuff. We have this ramp piece here that was kind of crudded up. This rides on top of this bar here in this position so that the ramp is inside, and that's what's going to raise and lower the feed dogs. So what we're going to do is we're going to get the rack in. We'll just put both of the screws lightly in place and then take the ramp and put it on to get it lined up. Just start the screws by hand a little bit. Then we'll go in with a real screwdriver and we'll tighten them up. Now, yeah, you can do this before it gets attached to the vertical feed, but what fun would that be? You got to make it so it's a challenge to get to the parts. That way you appreciate it more when you're done. Yes, that was dripping with sarcasm. Okay, so I got that in place. I've got an appropriate sized, or I thought I had an appropriate sized screwdriver bit. I do not. One moment. And it's a little thick too. That's a good size. Alright, so we got an appropriate size screwdriver bit. We snug these up. Now here comes the fun part once we get this snugged up. Okay? Now, there's a long screw on the face over here, much like you would find on some 66s for retaining the bobbin case positioning bracket. So what you want to do is you want to move this so this lever is all the way to the right hand side of the machine. Okay? And you'll know when it's there. You'll be able to feel it. And then you want to line up the rack and pinion. And I'll throw a picture in here so that the last tooth on the pinion is lined up with the last tooth on the rack, and I'll take a still of that and put that in there. Now, this piece here is kind of cool. It's got this eccentric bolt in it. It's got a big shoulder on it, and then the pin is what's eccentric, and it's off center, and it goes inside this post here. Now, there's no threads on this. This is what's getting retained by that piece up that I mentioned on the front. You slip that on, and then you adjust that eccentric to take the extra lash out of it so that there's no sloppiness, and then you tighten that screw on the front and that'll tighten up that eccentric shaft so it ain't going to move on you. Get there with the proper screwdriver, and there we go. Now, this hook is not timed at all, but it is in position, and that's what it takes to get the rack and pinion back together. But if you saw what this looked like before, I believe I used this machine. I might not have used this machine. This might, because I have more than one 285 now. But this machine was really, really grungy when I started taking it apart. So, for timing. Okay. I believe the size of this wrench is 7/64. I could be wrong. There is a set screw. I thought I had the right Allen wrench here. Yes, I do. There is a set screw on the side of this pinion gear. You loosen it, and you'll be able to get the gear in time when the appropriate time comes, once we have everything in the needle bar area ready to rock and roll. But that's all there is to it. Light bit of oil for lubrication, and that pretty much finishes up this portion of the hook drive. When you get the feed dog rock shaft in place, you're going to have the feed dogs on it pretty early in the game. You'll note that the pivot point for the rock shaft, when you're moving it, it's moving the whole arm, obviously, side to side, and there's a bearing on the arm, which is kept in contact with this spring coming off this bracket here. It's a little coil spring. So this little this bearing riding on this ramp is what raises and lowers the feed dogs, and its position is controlled with the stitch length regulator, that with the arm from the stitch length regulator moving against this tab, which moves that fore and aft, which is what's moving the feed dogs fore and aft, and it's riding on that ramp. Kind of a different way of doing it than, say, a 99 or a 66 or any of the, quote, real Singer sewing machines. Not that this isn't real. It's a good machine. Kinda. This is the needle bar. Notice there's two marks engraved all the way around on the needle bar. And how that works, well, here, I'll show you. Okay, timing this is pretty simple, actually. Start with the needle bar linkages all the way down so that the linkage will not travel any further down. And with the set screw loose, you can then move the needle bar up so that that top mark is even with the bottom of the casting, then go ahead and tighten the set screw. Now, okay, then once you have a needle in the needle clamp, move it so that the lower line is even with the bottom of the casting, and that's where you set your timing. It's that simple. Okay, now that I've got a needle and a clamp in the machine, and I've got the timing mark set so that lower mark is even with the bottom of the casting, it's simply a matter of using an eighth inch Allen key, loosening that set screw here, adjusting the position of the hook, so I can see right down here. I left the feed dogs in place, I didn't even take them off. I'm looking right through, I can see that the needle is even. Now, with the hook, point of the hook, I tighten it up, bada bing, bada boom. Easy peasy, lemon squeezy. Certainly, simple process. Well, I'm sorry this week's video wasn't more exciting, but at least it gives you an idea of what some of the things, interesting things are with the Singer 285J. Like I said, I should be back with something a lot more interesting next weekend.
And hopefully I'll have some stuff out during the week too. But regardless, thanks for watching. For those of you who already knew about me coming down with COVID and have been sending well wishes and stuff, thank you, thank you, thank you. I really do appreciate it. But other than that, thanks for watching, and we will see you on the next one. Hopefully without the coughing and sneezing.